All right, so let's talk about diabetic ketoacidosis. This is something that you may see during your time in the hospital. If you work in an ICU, a general medical ICU, you're going to see this often, as it is fairly common, but it requires very intensive monitoring of labs, frequent lab draws, cardiac monitoring, electrolyte monitoring. So there's a lot that goes on and that is involved with taking care of a diabetic ketoacidosis patient. So let's talk about it really quickly, and we're going to break it down very simply with our nursing care and what we need to know to understand these patients and take care of them. So first of all, this is going to occur with type 1 diabetic patients. What you remember with type 1 is it's an autoimmune disorder where our immune system destroys these beta cells that produce insulin. So we have extreme insulin deficiency or no insulin at all, and this leads to the, what happens is this ends up leading to the breakdown of fats into glucose, which results in ketone bodies, which are acidic. Okay, that's very simply. We're going to get into this a little bit more here. So we have severe insulin deficiency or no insulin at all, which leads to the breakdown of fats into glucose for energy, and that results in acidic ketones in the body. So very quickly, I'm going to tell you the assessment, and then we're going to go over it a little bit really quick. So what happens is it's a sudden onset. It's usually associated with infection or stress. You're going to notice fruity breath on your patient, and that is a result of those acid bodies, which have kind of a fruity smell. Ketones are going to be released into the urine. You're going to have severe hyperglycemia, generally in like the 400 to 600 range with DKA. You're going to have dehydration, and this is due to osmotic diuresis, which we'll go over a little bit more in the next slide. You're also going to have acidosis. Okay, what is acidosis? Acidosis is a pH of less than 7.35, right? And then it's going to be also an HCO3 of less than 22. Okay, so we're going to have a decrease in pH, and we're going to see a decrease in bicarb because of this acidosis. The reason acidosis occurs is because these fats are broken down into glucose. These ketones are a byproduct of the fat breakdown. Ketones are very acidic, and potassium begins to leave the cell as a result of this acidosis. You're also going to see these Kussmaul respirations in your patient, and like we said, this hyperkalemia. The hyperkalemia is associated with this acidosis. You're also going to see an elevated BUN and creatinine, and that's a result of this osmotic diuresis. As you begin to put out all this urine, you see an elevated creatinine associated with that renal failure. You're also going to want to monitor level of consciousness. Cerebral edema can occur due to this fluid shift as we become highly osmotic, and your patient's level of consciousness. Okay, so let's look at it one more time really quick. So what happens is we have a decreased level of insulin. Or essentially what happens is the body is no longer producing insulin, okay? So because we do not have insulin, all right? So our cell can use glucose and fatty acids to produce energy, right? And so within the mitochondria, it can break down glucose, it can break down fatty acids to produce ATP, right? But in order to use glucose, it has to have insulin, right? Okay, so here's our cell. Glucose is outside the cell. We've already talked about this before, that in order to get into the cell, it needs insulin. So without the presence of insulin, glucose is unable to get into the cell. So glucose is going to remain outside the cell, all right? But the cell has another way that it can use energy. It can actually break down fatty acids, okay? So when these fatty acids are broken down, we get enough energy to kind of carry out cellular metabolism, but we still remain with this glucose outside the cell, okay? So what happens when we do not have insulin is the cell starts to break down fatty acids. Okay, this leads to acidosis, okay, which is our pH less than 7.35, and a bicarb of less than 22. Okay. Now it's going to be an anion gap acidosis. If you want to learn more about that, there's actually some really good videos on YouTube by MedCram about what anion gap is. But for our purposes, we just need to understand that this is going to lead to acidosis. Due to this acidosis, we're also going to see hyperkalemia. Okay? Now, it also leads to when we do not have insulin, this is also going to lead to an elevated glucose level, right? So glucose is not getting into the cell, so our glucose is rising within our blood. So our glucose continues to rise because we are not pulling it into the cell to use it. Instead, we're using these fatty acids. So as that glucose rises, this is going to lead to osmotic diuresis. Okay, which simply means that our osmotic pressure becomes so great that the kidneys begin to dump it all. Okay, and this is going to lead to the renal failure and the elevated creatinine. Okay, so that's kind of what's happening here. Two things are happening, and that's what we need to understand. Two things are happening. We're breaking down fatty acids, and that's leading to acidosis. We're also not using glucose, and that's leading to hyperglycemia. Okay, so now that we have those two things understood, okay, now you understand it very simply here, right? It's very, very simple once we break it down like this. We do not have insulin available, so our body has to get that energy from somewhere, right? The place that it's getting that energy is from breaking down these fatty acids. Now, we just said right there, these are fatty acids. So we're going to develop acidosis, okay? And because of that, we're going to develop hyperkalemia. Now, the other thing that's happening here, we still have all this glucose circulating in the cells, or without in the blood. So we still have all this glucose circulating in the blood. That's leading to hyperglycemia. At the same time, we're developing this acidosis. So we're diabetic ketoacidosis, okay? So our blood sugars are going to rise, and again, they're not going to rise as high as they are in like HHNS because we're using a little bit of this energy, okay? So how are we going to treat these patients, okay? We're going to treat these patients with very intensive insulin therapy. What insulin is going to do for us, it's going to do a couple things. Insulin is going to help to correct this acidosis, okay? It's also going to help to lower the glucose, okay? But our goal here with diabetic ketoacidosis is to correct this acidosis. That's our primary concern here, is correcting this acidosis. As we correct that acidosis, our potassium is going to improve, right? We know that insulin is one of the therapies for hyperkalemia, right? With insulin, we can pull potassium back into the cell. And with insulin also, we can correct acidosis, okay? So the other thing that it's going to do at the same time, however, is it's going to correct our glucose level. So as we're correcting our acidosis, we're also correcting our glucose level. Remember, our patient is also very dehydrated. And so what are we going to give for dehydration? Well, we're going to give fluids. So we're going to give fluids to our patient. That's going to correct the dehydration and due to this osmotic diuresis. So we correct that osmotic diuresis by giving fluids, and that helps to correct that patient there. Then we give our insulin to correct the acidosis, and that also brings down our blood sugars, okay? So we're going to treat the dehydration. We're going to place the patient on intensive insulin therapy. We're going to monitor potassium, and we're going to assess for and treat acidosis. If you want to learn more about this anion gap acidosis, you can check out the Merck manual. That's one resource you can check out there. But that's really kind of the basics. If you can draw this diagram, you get DKA, okay? And if you get DKA, you get the treatments, and you're understanding better ABGs and everything that's going on there, okay? So that's really what's going on with DKA, and that's how you can understand why it pertains only, well, most commonly to type 1 diabetics, and why it's different than HHNS, okay? So that's what we need to understand here. If you have any questions with that, guys, please let me know.